to A Wee Bit of War, a podcast dedicated to telling stories of Northern Ireland during the Second World War. I'm your host, Scott Edgar, and in this episode, we're joined by Lorna Quin from County Armagh. Over the last number of years, Lorna has been collecting, collating and editing stories from members of her local community, from people who remember life in Northern Ireland during wartime. Last year, she published the first collection under the title, Yes, We Have No Bananas. It's an excellent read, particularly if you enjoy social history and those real-life stories that we so often feature on Wartime NI. Lorna, welcome to the podcast. We're delighted to have you join us.
Thanks very much for your invite.
In recent episodes, I have dived into my personal story a few times, telling how I became interested in this particular area of Northern Ireland's history, and I've been into it since I was relatively young. Has it been the same for you? Is this a lifelong passion, or how did you come to be intrigued by these tales of the Second World War in Northern Ireland?
Well, I was thinking about that. I was thinking, you know, what did start it off? Well, remember when a young child and an older cousin of my dad's coming to visit, and he had been in the RAF during the war. And I remember not wanting to go outside to play, but I remember sitting in the living room on the carpet and listening enthralled as he told his stories of being in the RAF in the Far East. And it was just, they were just mesmerizing tales. And I think that, you know, that got me interested. And then I remember in P7, my class teacher, Tandragee Primary School, my class teacher reading The Silver Sword to us as the class novel by Ian Sorelli, the story of three Polish children, and then another wee boy joins them, and it's their journey, to survival, really, through the war years. And it was that sense of children against a bigger enemy, and the father had been arrested by the Gestapo, and it was that sense of injustice and their bravery that appealed to me. And then I also remember the film Carve Our Name with Pride, which even when I was wee was an oldie, but it was, the bravery of Violette in the French Resistance. It was just, I can't describe it. It really intrigued me, that whole, a girl being so brave and a real heroine.
And in my introduction there, I mentioned your book that came out last year, Yes, We Have No Bananas, in which you took kind of a look at the social history and a look at real life stories from people predominantly in and around County Armagh. What was it that made you want to commit these stories to paper? How did the book come about, really?
Well, I began talking to my old primary school teacher about what it was like growing up during the war years. And she told me that officials came round and measured their front door to see if the door was wide enough to take civilian casualties. And I thought, you know, that's really fascinating, because, you know, for a government to get down into that detail of, measuring people's front door, for this whole war machine, you know, to get into progress, to fight the enemy. This is the detail that needed to be taken. And then because she grew up in Market Hill, obviously that was close to Gosford, and then you have her mother being asked whether she would take evacuees or soldiers' wives. They chose soldiers' wives. And then the story of, a strange family coming to live in your, you know, being given over to one room in the house and living in that one room. And then I said, I would love to hear more. And, you know, she said, why don't you ask my sister-in-law? She was older and she would have more memories. And so it just snowballed, Scott. And because these people, the memories are going through the decades, and we're not going to have these stories forever. And I thought, you know, I have enough here to write a book. As it snowballed, the project snowballed, and I wanted to capture these stories for posterity. They're so precious. Each one is unique. Each one is different. and the details in them that people remember over so many years is just fascinating. It's a fascinating time for children to be, to live through. And it was to me, it was like as if they were living in a movie scene, with all this going on around them.
Occasionally, we here at Wartime NI receive emails or messages with little snippets of information here and there, and that sparks a flurry of research. In your book, you have some very different stories, and they come from a very wide range of people. How did you go about finding these stories or finding the information for these?
Well, Scott, there were friends or friends of friends, and someone told me you should ask such and such a one, or I thought, I bet you that person has a good story, and I had to go by their age as well, because the people over 90 are obviously going to have, the more memories than, a child of 4 or 5. And I was fortunate enough also to interview a lady who was in her 102nd year at the time. So she was a young adult, and she was telling me about going to dances in Gosford. She was telling me about the troops, the local troops coming to the dances in Market Hill every week. And as a young girl, she was different dance partners every week. And she was able to tell me that, and I just thought that was, wow, amazing.
And of course, we have you on the podcast now because the big news is that volume two of the book is out just in time for Christmas. What can people expect from the next batch of stories?
Well, the next batch of stories, I have broadened my geographical range this time, Scott. Yes, I've got a lot of stories from Northern Ireland. I've got a super story from a wee boy who grew up in Derry. So he saw the German submarines, come into Lissahalle, and at the end of the war. And I have a story from Fermanagh. I have two stories from south of the border. So that gives us a glimpse of what it was like during the emergency, as they called it, during those war years. I have two American stories. So I have two American kids. I see these old people just as kids because, they're telling me their story, but it stops at the end of the war. So they're children in my eyes, and not old people. But I've got, he remembers the wee American boy remembers coming out of the cinema. And he said it seemed like the whole world was crying, and that's when obviously when Pearl Harbor was attacked, and the little girl remembers, she remembers exactly what she was doing when news broke out that America had entered the war. So she was coming home in the bus, and I've got that perspective, and I've also through a friend of a friend. Got the story of a young girl who grew up in Austria under the Nazis,
Oh,
and I've
wow.
got her story. So I've widened my geographical net this time.
So just briefly going back to the first book, when I was at school, I was best friends. I went to school in Portadown and grew up near Tandragee, which is where I believe you went to school. And back then, I was best friends with a fella from Hamilton's Bon, and it was a lovely experience for me to see his father's story of American GIs in County Armagh in the first book. That was one of my favourite moments in there, even though it maybe wasn't the best of the stories that were in there, but it just had a nice personal touch for me. Do you have any favourites from that first book, or maybe one or two that you'd like to share with us?
Well, I think that every story is a real gem, Scott. Every story is unique. One of the Banbridge ones is that James remembers on VE night being kissed by a Belgian soldier in the middle of Banbridge Street. Now, he was given a continental kiss. And in those days, like, men just didn't show their emotions at all. Ulster men didn't show their emotions, but to be kissed in both cheeks in the middle of Banbridge Street was something, you know, that he remembered all those years later. And of course, the meals that, the food that the Americans give the kids when they brought them into Gosford, George McHugh says that he never tasted anything like it in his life since, and he thinks it might have been watered down condensed milk, but he doesn't know. It was such a beautiful taste, you know. So, and then someone else, well, I think it was Sam, remembers the food being like an artist's palette. It was so colourful. So obviously, you know, through rationing and all the rest, this was just wonderful for these kids.
And yeah, it's hard for us to imagine what, you know, what life was like back then, and there was that kind of lack of colour and lack of excitement, you know, maybe certainly out in those rural areas. And I've read a lot from the flip side of that, you know, letters home from American GIs who write about how quaint and rural and you know lovely and ancient and historic Ireland or Northern Ireland is.
Yes.
But to have that to have that reaffirmed then, you know, the other way around, and the stories of the drama and excitement and colour and things that the troops brought in is just amazing. Do you find it particularly interesting that these stories all or predominantly have like a childlike aspect to them, or, you know, they're seen through very young, innocent, naive perspectives?
Yes. Well, several of the people mentioned that. I mean, obviously, their parents were more worried than they were. And they, you know, they enjoyed the sweets from the Americans, and they enjoyed, you know, seeing them march up and down Tandragee Street. They, you know, Uncle John lay in a ditch and watched the Belgian troops march down the road, and then be joined by other Belgian troops who had been hiding in a ditch. You know, all these memories are, it must have been such an exciting time that as a backdrop to their normal life, you know, they saw all these things going on, and yet, you know, it was normal to them, but it must have been very, very exciting and special. I mean, to see a tank up close and to see the guy with the earphones on when you may not even have had a wireless at home.
Yeah, I've seen photos of kind of tanks and military vehicles coming out of that gate of Tandragee
Castle
at the top of the town.
Castle. Marvelous, marvelous.
I used to work in there. I used to work for Tato back in my student days.
And so did I, Scott. So did I. Did you eat the crisps? Did you eat the crisps?
We certainly had our fill of them. Yeah, I think it's a rite of passage for anyone who's grown up in that area. But even now, you know, I'm a lot older now than I was back then. But I still can't get my head around what it must have been like to watch, to watch a Stuart tank just drive out that gate and start coming down the main street.
Yes. And to share your home, you know, to share your home with complete strangers, or to have a rap on the door at night and go to the door and there's a family from Belfast and they're looking for some shelter for the night. And that shelter, you know, you bring them in and then they get a wee house in the area and they never go back to Belfast because they love the country. And at night time to hear, you know, to hear the last post every night coming from Gosford and Reveille in the morning. I mean, wow. And to have American troops come into your house every night for a chat with your dad. Wow.
Yeah, and not just Americans. There are several of the stories in your book and possibly the next book as well have soldiers from all across the world. You've mentioned the Belgians there, so it's a huge kind of mishmash of people from across the globe that descended upon Northern Ireland, and as well as soldiers, we had evacuees from Gibraltar, we had Jewish kids around Mellisle, and it just must have been an absolutely amazing experience for particularly those younger kids who maybe didn't realize quite how strange all of this was. It was just part of their growing up.
And for them, we're going to the next big town was an event, and yet on their doorstep were all these different nationalities. I have in the second book, I have a lovely wee story. I've made contact with the daughter of a lady who fell in love with one of those American soldiers and went as in the very early wave as a GI bride to America. So I have her story.
That's fascinating. I'm looking forward to reading that. That's gonna be one of many stories in the new book. It is available now, and how would you, I mean, you've already whet the appetite of our listeners here, I feel, but if there's one little snippet of a story that you think is a really good hook, what would be in there that would really grab people's attention?
Well, I have a lovely story of a wee boy in brought up in the south of County Armagh, very rural, and the Americans come to the door, and they're in a jeep, and they ask his mum if they can borrow this little boy to show them where the next place they have to go, and the little boy gets into the American jeep and, gets driven round his local area in the back of an American jeep. Now, how cool is that for a young lad? Getting driven around South Armagh in the back of an American jeep. It must be like just stepping into the movies.
But that's an incredibly cool story, and actually, it makes me think. Last year, I was out at an event at Derrymore House in Bessbrook, so in South Armagh, and they had a range of American Jeeps there, and they took a few kids around for a spin around the estate. So these kids were sitting in the back of these Jeeps, and it just kids of like 5, 6, 7, 8 years old, and they're still incredibly excited about doing that now, 80 years later, even with all of the things, the technology we have, and iPads and whatever, kids are still enthralled by being in the back of an American Jeep. So I can't even begin to contemplate the excitement that must have had, 80 years ago.
I have another story now. This one is a young lad, a young boy walking to school on the outskirts of Armagh, a wee country school, and they had to pass under what would have been the Armagh Portadown railway line, and there was a bridge. And during the night, the soldiers, these are British soldiers, had been in Armagh, and they'd been walking back to their barracks, using the railway line to guide them. But what happened was the last train came along from Portadown, and two soldiers were hit by the train. And as the wee boy was walking to school the next morning, unfortunately, these two dead soldiers are lying on the road, and he remembers seeing the boot of one of them, separated from the body. And even today, all these years later, going under that bridge brings back those memories of walking to school, and the whole thing was just unraveling at the time. The dead soldiers had just been found, and that's a very vivid memory, obviously, for that wee lad.
Goodness, yeah, it's a sobering reminder that, as much fun as many of these stories may be, and we talk about riding in jeeps and getting chocolate and candy from American GIs, we were at war, and tragic accidents like that happened, but then also you had the kind of constant reminder through newspapers and through the radio, you know, that we were at war. And then, of course, in 1941, the Luftwaffe attack Northern Ireland. And we've a whole raft of different experiences then for young people. And I think you've some stories about evacuees coming down from Belfast to seek refuge out in more rural parts of County Armagh.
Yes, and I have got a super story from Roger who lived in Belfast and was in the middle of this blitz. Do you want me to read a wee bit out of it, Scott? Just a wee extract?
Yeah, that would be wonderful.
Okay. The first one was at Easter 1941, and I was away in the Glens with the School Natural History Society. But as the bus on which we were returning home came down the Antrim Road, we passed rows of smashed houses, with soldiers clearing the partly blocked road. The worst damage was in the Antrim Road area, as the German pilots were said to have mistaken the waterworks reservoirs for the harbour. The second attack came a few days later when I was at home, and this time the city centre and the industrial area were hit hard. Air raid precautions were primitive at that stage, so my father, a volunteer warden, was outside equipped with an ARP armband, a tin hat and little else. Along with my mother and brother, I was under the solid oak dining table. The air raid shelter in the cellar came later and ended up as a turf store. The thing I remember most vividly was the noise. There was a battery of heavy anti-aircraft guns at the King's Hall, and every time they were fired, the house shook. When we came out, we found that the only damage was that the heavy plaster ceiling in the drawing room had swung down from one end, taking the light fitting with it. It was only held up with heavy ceiling paper. Going into town a few days later, the extent of the damage was all too clear, for the many buildings were down or still smouldering. So, you know, for that there, that's a first-hand account of two of those raids.
And amazing how that the level of detail and the feeling behind it all is still there,
yes,
still very much present.
It's still there, yes. Mm-hmm. Many of the evacuees, you know, came and they never went back to the city again. You know, they liked the country life. And you know, realized that it was a much much healthier environment, and never went back.
I think that there may be equal parts there. I've certainly come across many stories of those who didn't go back and kind of enjoyed the rural landscapes and that. But there were even by the time of the Blitz, because evacuation started in 1940, and by the time the Luftwaffe attacked in 1941, a lot of the first evacuees had returned
yes.
to the city. So a lot of those inner city kids were, just being brutally honest, they were ridiculously bored in the country, and they missed
yes.
Kicking football in yeah. the streets with their friends and whatnot. So
yes, Scott, I have forgot to tell you, I have in the second book been allowed access to a young RAF sergeant's writing, and he wrote this for a particular RAF history project, and so this is the story of Bob McHugh, who grew up in Hampton's Bon. Now, it starts off his childhood in the 30s. And then it goes into him joining the RAF, and it goes through his wartime experiences. So I have been allowed to use his writings, and they're written in the first person for the second book. And I honestly think they would make a film. You know, on his 21st birthday, his best friend was killed just beside him. There's no counselling. There's no time to grieve or that. So you pick yourself up on a way on to the next, you know, to your next posting. He lost 4 stone in weight when he was actually moved over into the continent then for operations. eating camel steaks, lifting lifting a live mine. I couldn't tell you all the stories, but they're his own writings. So they're straight from the horse's mouth. They're eyewitness account of what it was like to join the RAF during those wonderful years. Wonderful. When I say wonderful years, special years.
And were these written at the time? Were these written in the 1940s or written after the
They
war?
no, they were written after the war. They were written after the war. the first part of his childhood were written for his niece, particularly for his niece, and the part about his service in the RAF was written particularly for an RAF history project.
Well, I personally I'm really looking forward to reading those in the next book. Both these books are a wonderful collection of stories and a great addition to the ever-growing canon of literature on Northern Ireland during the Second World War. And if I know most people listen to these podcasts, but if you're watching the ones that we upload to YouTube, you will see the bookshelves straining behind me there. So there's plenty to read on these subjects. If people want to keep up with you and your latest work, how can they do so? And more importantly, where can they pick up a copy of the latest book?
Well, I'd say that without me going on too much, my Facebook page gives details of all the shops which are kindly selling the book, and all profits from the book are going into research for Parkinson's disease.
That's absolutely fantastic. It's a great cause, and I was very happy to pick up the last book. I got mine from Winnie's in Portadown, but there are plenty of other shops across County Armagh, some in County Down, one in Belfast. We'll post up links to your Facebook page in the show notes here, and let people know where they can get those. Lorna, thank you very much for joining us on A Wee Bit of War, and for talking us through just some of the stories in your two books. We hope to hear even more stories about wartime County Armagh, the rest of Northern Ireland, and even further afield as you've covered now soon. With the second book out, are there plans for a third, or what is next for Lorna Quin?
Well, I think I'll have a wee break now from the writing, and I have to concentrate on selling the books. So I'll be concentrate my efforts on that aspect of, because when you write a book, you've got to sell it. So that's what I'll be doing in the next wee while, Scott.
Well, I think you've given it some good promotion on here, and hopefully a few of our listeners that are based in and around Northern Ireland will pick those up and help with that mission. Thank you very much for joining me, and yeah, I look forward to reading the book and catching up with you again soon.
Thanks very much, Scott. I appreciate you giving me some airtime.
Subscribe to A Wee Bit of War on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, or wherever you get your favorite shows. That way, you'll never miss an episode. Tell your friends, tell your family, tell your co-workers. Break all the rules of the Official Secrets Act, and why not even leave a review to help others find the podcast? Thank you for joining myself and Lorna Quin, and I look forward to your company again next time for another Wee Bit of War.